Here we go, make me think.
The August 18th, 2020 meeting of the City Council of the City of Springfield, Illinois is called to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Clerk, if you please call the roll.
Will do. Alderman Redpath.
Here.
Alderman Gregory.
Here.
Alderwoman Turner.
Here.
Alderman Fulgenzi. Alderwoman DeCenso.
Present.
Alderman Proctor.
Here.
Alderwoman Connolly.
Present.
Alderman McMiniman.
Also present.
Alderman Donilon.
Here.
Alderman Hanauer.
Here.
Mayor Langfelder.
Here.
Mr. Mayor, a quorum is present.
Thank you. The first item on the zoning agenda is docket number 2020-028 for the property located at 44 West Fairview Lane. Petitioners Reginald Bulkley and Carol Dunaway as leaseholders. Present zoning classification is R1, single family residence district, section 155.016. Requested zoning relief, a variance of section 9 docs of Appendix A of the land use plan for Lake Springfield and its marginal properties to allow the new dock structure to be a maximum of 48 feet from the shoreline at normal pool elevation instead of the maximum of 35 feet. Springfield-Sangamon County Regional Planning staff recommendation is denial. Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation is approve the petition as submitted. Chair will entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we accept the Planning and Zoning Commission's recommendation.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to accept the Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation. Second, any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The clerk will call the roll.
Alderman Redpath.
Aye.
Alderman Gregory.
Aye.
Alderwoman Turner.
Yes.
Alderman Fulgenzi. Alderman Proctor.
Yes.
Alderwoman DeCenso.
Yes.
Alderman McMiniman.
Yes.
Alderwoman Connolly.
Yes.
Alderman Donilon.
Aye.
Alderman Hanauer.
Aye.
10 ayes and no nays, Miss.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is docket number 2020-030 for the property located at 913 South 9th Street. Petitioners George Alarm Company Incorporated. Present zoning classification is B1, General Business Service District, section 155.033. Requested zoning relief, a variance of section 155.157, discontinuance of use in the B1 Highway Business Service District, section 155.033, to allow a single family residence to again be used as a non-conforming single family residence. Springfield-Sangamon County Regional Planning staff recommendation is denial. Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation is grant the petition as submitted. The chair will entertain a motion.
I would move to accept the Planning and Zoning Commission's recommendation.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to accept the Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation as approved the petition as submitted. Second, any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The clerk will call the roll.
Alderman Redpath.
Aye.
Alderman Gregory.
Aye.
Alderwoman Turner.
Yes.
Alderman Fulgenzi. Alderman Proctor.
Yes.
Alderwoman DeCenso.
Yes.
Alderman McMiniman.
Yes.
Alderwoman Connolly.
Yes.
Alderman Donilon.
Aye.
Alderman Hanauer.
Aye.
10 ayes and no nays, Mayor.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is docket number 2020-031 for the property located at 256 Maple Grove Lane. Petitioner is David and Heather Cohn as lake leaseholders. Present zoning classification is R1, single family residence district, section 155.016. Requested zoning relief, a variance of Appendix A, Section 3, setbacks of the land use plan for Lake Springfield and its marginal properties to allow the installation of the in-ground pool to the south side of the existing house to be 45 feet from the shoreline at its closest point and the concrete pool deck 41 feet from the shoreline at its closest point instead of the 75 feet required setback. Springfield Sangamon County Regional Planning staff recommendation is denial. Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation is grant the petition as submitted. Chair will entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we accept the Planning and Zoning Commission's recommendation for approval.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to accept the Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation for approval and second. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion vote yes. Those opposed vote no. The clerk will call the roll.
Alderman Redpath.
Aye.
Alderman Gregory.
Aye.
Alderwoman Turner.
Yes.
Alderman Fulgenzi.
Aye.
Alderman Proctor.
Yes.
Alderwoman DeCenso.
Yes.
Alderman McMiniman.
Yes.
Alderwoman Conley.
Yes.
Alderman Donlin.
Aye.
Alderman Hanauer.
Aye.
10 ayes and no nays, Mayor.
Thank you. The last item on the agenda is docket number 2020-032 for the property located at 1501 Leland Avenue. Petitioner is Brent J. Colbert and Jessica A. Narduli. Present zoning classification is R1 single family residence district section 155.016. Requested zoning relief, a variance of section 155.068, garages or accessory buildings or structures to construct a new garage measuring 24 feet by 30 feet with the north wall of the structure 2 feet from the north line property line and the west wall of the structure 1 feet from the west property line instead of the 3 feet per code. Springfield Sangamon County Regional Planning staff recommendation is approval. Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation is accept the recommendation of the Springfield Sangamon County Regional Planning staff. Chair will entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, move to accept the Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation for approval.
Second.
Then moved and second to accept the Planning and Zoning Commission recommendation for approval and second. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion vote yes. Those opposed vote no. The clerk will call the roll.
Alderman Redpath.
Aye.
Alderman Gregory.
Aye.
Alderwoman Turner.
Yes.
Alderman Fulgenzi.
Aye.
Alderman Proctor.
Yes.
Alderwoman DeCenso.
Yes.
Alderman McMiniman.
Yes.
Alderwoman Connolly.
Yes.
Alderman Donlin.
Aye.
Alderman Hanauer.
Aye.
10 ayes and no nays, Mayor.
Thank you. And that concludes the zoning portion of our meeting. This time, the chair will recognize Treasurer Buescher for the presentation of the financial report.
Thank you, Mayor Langfelder. The corporate fund in the month of July had a beginning balance of $13,071,645. We took in total receipts of $9,215,108. We had total disbursements in the month of July of $7,828,168, which left the corporate fund with an ending balance in the month of July of $14,458,585. This concludes my report, Mayor Langfelder.
Thank you. Chair will entertain a motion to approve the financial report.
So move.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Opposed say nay. Motion carries. We have three presentations at the beginning of the meeting and one at the end. But Director McCarty is going to give a financial update. You would please?
5 minutes.
Bill's been practicing.
I think we're more concerned about you, Mayor.
Thank you.
Should we have the clock started? Thank you, Bill.
Should have brought staff.
It's a tough crowd.
I'll just say the end. We'll be done with it.
Like, here, we'll pass them along. Thank you, I'll pass them along.
You pass them on?
Yep. Thank you.
I'm just giving you an update from last month, that's all.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, council. Mayor just asked me to give you a brief update. We did get the May sales tax numbers, and he wanted me to update our projections, which, of course, we're going to do anyway, and then present it to the council. So I don't have the clicker, though. This doesn't count against me. That's at least 30 seconds right there.
I got you. Don't worry.
Thank you, Alderman. I appreciate that. The only thing we updated were sales tax. The other numbers with, we're still using IML numbers for income and PPRT and our hotel motel tax that we had actually tracking with what Director Dahl has been giving us. In fact, I just got some updated numbers from him this evening, late today, and we're tracking in line, so there was no need to change that. Sales tax was a nice surprise. Obviously, we're still down. We are in a pandemic, and places are still either closed or operating at reduced capacity. But if you do have your sheets and you look back the last month, we had originally the 21 and 26% for state and local sales tax down in July, which is April. From there, we had projected coming back a 3% growth, but actually was a 7% better than what we anticipated. Instead of being down 18%, for instance, in state, we were down only 14%. We took the new numbers, used that as our new baseline, changed everything going forward. And if you click or go a couple pages up, this is not working. Oh, here we go. Oh, that's the one I wanted. No, one. There we go. That's the one I want. Because I'm not going to go through the detail. You all can look at that later. But this is the summary. So
you have to click it.
Yeah.
That's the one you want?
Well, no. It went back again. Maybe there's a delay.
You're stalling, Bill.
I'm not. I promise I'm not.
Should have started the clock.
See, I'm pushing the button here.
There you go.
It might change. Well, anyway, you've got it in front of you. So our revenue shortfall in Scenario A goes from around a little over 10 million down to 8.7 million. Scenario B goes from somewhere around 12 million down to 9.9. So it improved somewhere between 1 or 2 million, depending on the scenario, looking at either A or B, which is certainly good news. We are hoping to see more improvement, a bigger jump from May to June and then June to July. But until we have those numbers, it's very hard for us to say. So hopefully in a couple of months when we've got those, we'll have a really good baseline to be able to project going forward. And then it's just a matter of how long the pandemic goes on and when there's a vaccine, et cetera. So if you were to look at that and we were to come up with scenario A or B, your fund balance usage would be or ending fund balance would be there on the right-hand side. We'd be down to 12.2 or 11.4, 9.6 or 8.1 is how to read that. Because remember, we did budget $1.6 million worth of fund balance, planned usage of fund balance at the beginning. So moving forward, this is just the P&L or income statement. You can see there across the bottom with the yellow, the same numbers I just gave you, where you end up, 12.2, 11.4. This assumes no cuts. Again, we're looking at expenses, still having those conversations with the mayor. But as of right now, this just incorporates the new revenue projections. The next two slides I'm not going to read. They're more for you to look at later, but these are kind of our guides for the CARES Act and then the Cures Act from the state, the types of things that we can put in for. And it seems to, well, as I said before, it's fluid. We keep getting changes on that. We just had a meeting with representatives from FEMA yesterday out at the Sangamon County Emergency Operations Center, and that was a good meeting with some of their reps, and we got a better idea of some of the things we can put in for. And we have a lot more confidence in some of the things we were thinking about that were on the fence. So we're continuing to put that together. And in fact, this is where we are to date. We have a reasonable high degree of confidence that we've got roughly $220,000 worth of operational costs like PPE and the plexiglass that's around you, et cetera, the thermometers. We think that we certainly are in line for $165,000 worth of reimbursements for overtime and some other salary and benefits that we consider a slam dunk. And then we've got a large chunk there you can see in red of about $1.3 million that's still under review. Part of the problem we're having is some of the records are not as easily accessible, and we're having to do a lot of this through manual and tedious work to try and comb through, because there are certain components that we feel we can put in for, certain components that we can't, and it wasn't all captured in the system the way we had hoped. It's just the way it is. So it's going to take time, and we continue to go through it. But Right now, we are hopeful we're moved somewhere up into the $1.7 to $2 million worth of reimbursement range, assuming we can get through all this and all of it ends up reimbursable. That's all I have. Any questions?
Mr. Mayor.
John. Yes, Alderman McMillan, then Alderman Donlin.
Director, go to the first chart.
That one?
That one.
All right.
Just for simplicity, the top few rows talk about state sales tax. And we've got some actual numbers and mm-hmm. some projected numbers for what will happen with the state sales tax. Mm-hmm. The chart projects our revenue through May of 2021.
That's through the end of the fiscal year. Remember, there's a natural delay in sales tax.
The chart itself, though, shows through May of 2021.
Yes,
So what you're about to say is that we're on a fiscal basis, which ends February of 2021, but because we're on a accrual accounting instead of cash accounting, we're going to be looking at actual receipts we get in March, April, and May of 2021, because that's what our budget year will look at for the budget fiscal year that ends February 21.
Right. You're right. We are on a modified accrual basis, so that May number you see will be allocated back to February in this current fiscal year. And you bring up or remind me of a good point is that this is where we are right now. So even if the powers that be, everyone around the horseshoe, felt that the best course of action for the city would be to just, okay, we've got our reserves, we built them up, we planned for a rainy day, we actually have a rainy day fund, and we should utilize that to get through this. Understand, what I'm showing is only for the fiscal year through February. We haven't even started talking about next year and next year's budget. In all likelihood, even if there's a vaccine at some point late in the year or early next year, and depending on who you talk to, they'll tell you something different, we're going to see an impact in the next year's budget. That, in conjunction with natural increases, for instance, pensions, we're looking at somewhere probably, based on what we have now, somewhere around $1.7 million more in police and fire pensions next year. We do have a draft of fire. It's almost $1 million. We're waiting on police. We looked at last year's and what the projection might be for police. Fire was pretty close to last year's projection, and police was somewhere in the $700,000-$800,000. So we're looking at $1.7 to $1.8 million potentially in new expenses next year on top of decreased revenue. So there's that to keep that in mind as you think about the numbers that I'm showing you and what that may or may not mean in terms of the reserves and usage of fund balance.
Thank you.
Alderman Donlin.
Thank you, Mayor. Director, I appreciate the update on the revenue numbers. I was hoping that we would also get an update on what the plan is to fill the hole. According to these numbers, it's anywhere from $8.6 to $14 million. Let's be conservative on the number and estimate on the low side. It's 8.6, almost 8.7. How are we going to come up with it? Obviously, we can utilize fund balance, but according to these numbers I see in front of me, and correct me if I'm wrong, that fund balance would go down from anywhere from 12.2% to 8.1%. My understanding that is closer to 10% we get, there's times when we can't make payroll.
Well, it all depends on cash flow. I think 10% we're probably okay from a cash flow standpoint. We have utilized passive borrowing in the past in order to make payroll. Is it the most fiscally sound thing to do? No. No, I would agree with you 100%. It's not. I personally am not for utilizing fund balance for everything.
Right.
I don't think it's the fiscally responsible thing to do, but there are other matters that have to be considered by the powers that be, the mayor and the voting members of the council, to make that ultimate determination. What I've done thus far, what my office has done thus far, is we have met with the mayor recently. We provided several options to look at and consider, and right now those are under consideration in his office, and I'll kick it up to him if he wants to comment any more on that, where we are with it.
Yeah, with regards to that, that's the reason we put in it's the second footnote on there, the corporate fund policy from 8 to 16%. I think the comfortable margin would be 12%, I think is what the preferred ending balance would be. And so that's what our target will be with regards to that. But, you know, the fluctuation, there will be some items that we're considering with consolidation. I think there's areas that we can move together as far as shared services, especially on the buildings and ground side of things. So we're going to take a hard look at that. But there's going to be some hard conversations with regards to, you know, a couple of departments. They still continue, everybody continues to slow down spending, slow down hiring, and hopefully you have some, well, we will have some savings with regards to that. Continue to look at the CARES Act because, you know, there's dedicated $4.8 million towards Springfield just based on our population, I guess is how they came up with
CARES
that
CARES Act, yes.
And
correct.
So we'll continue to turn over all those avenues as much as possible, and then the combination of that will be considered the last resort for me, of course, and probably for all of us, is layoffs or, you know, personnel impact of the current employment base. So that's what we'll use that priority list.
Well, I appreciate that information. I was hoping we could have a plan and hear what the plan is. And, you know, let's be clear about, you kept saying powers that be, including all of us at this horseshoe. We, of course, want to be updated on what's going on, but our responsibility, fiscal responsibility, is, I know I'm telling you things you well know, to be the watchdog of the city council. And we're also responsible for passing a budget prior to the beginning of our fiscal year. We've done that. We've given the spending authority. Granted, certain things have to come back to us if they go over a certain threshold, but the revenue, due to COVID, hasn't come in. And so we have a hole. It's either 8.6 or 14 million. Pick a number in the middle. How are we going to come up with that money? And every day we wait, it gets worse. And you gave your first presentation, I think, about is either 3 or 4 weeks ago, and we've been given an update with revenue numbers are a little better. Let's assume we get all the CARES money, and you outlined about 1.7 million. Let's say we get it all. It's rounded up to 2 million. We're still $6 to $12 million in the hole. And you know, the longer we wait, that hard decision that you talked about, Mayor, is absolutely right. It impacts employees greater and greater. The longer we wait. So, you know, I'm just going to ask very bluntly, Bill. When are we going to have the plan? So when are you going to show us what your plan is?
Well, I provided the mayor with a lot of options, and it's under consideration. I don't get to call the shots. I'm not the elected official. I'm working with the mayor, and as soon as he's got a comfort level with what he wants to do, we'll roll it out. Other than that, that's where we are. It's under consideration.
The real item that we're all facing right now, I mean, you see that the case is going up.
Right.
I'm not worried about today. I'm probably worried about come the fall and the winter. I think that's where the situation could really turn upside down. I mean, it could get a lot worse. It could get better. As we've shown, I think May's numbers were better than expected, so they can go positive, which they have had the past month. But if the case is still kind of spiral, out of control, which is beyond all of our controls. We, you know, preach the mask wearing and social distancing, things of that nature. And that's the importance, is to make sure we stay in phase four. And as we know, I think Chief Riney, or I'll send out a COVID update later tonight, but one of the regions, I think it might have been region five.
Four.
Is region four? Is that on the watch list? Stepping it back.
Yes. Right.
And actually, we were progressive with that, where they're saying, okay, everybody has to have a seat at a restaurant or bar. We did that at the last executive order. So they're moving that direction. But the other side of it is with regards to closing at 11 for all restaurants and bars, things of that nature. So hopefully we don't have to go down that path. But it's really incumbent upon everybody to stay in that positive direction. But really, the concern is going to be the winter time. How's that impact us? And but you know, I think with regards to the millions of dollars, yeah, it's going to be a nutcracking time, and nobody's going to like it. And those are tough discussions that we'll have to have with some of the unions, and move forward in that direction. Because as we all know, when it comes to that point in time, it's going to be talking personnel. I mean, quite honestly, as far as that goes. So I think there's still flexibility with regards to that. I think you know, the numbers change each and every day, and nobody wants to tell somebody you have to take furloughs or you have to be laid off or what have you. So we're going to be cognizant of the fact and reducing expenditures as much as possible. But if it comes to that, we will have to take that into consideration. So I imagine it might be a blend, but we're working through that.
Well, Mayor, I appreciate your comments because what I heard you saying is we're not going to rely solely on fund balance, and there's going to be, and I just encourage those conversations. Again, I'm not trying to be preachy, but those conversations need to happen now because it's, again, every day we wait, the worse it gets. And you're right. I think the winter weather is probably going to make it worse, unfortunately. So we've got to prepare and be the most conservative we can be with the numbers.
And Alderman, I can appreciate your comments. And I know you especially better than probably than just about anybody in here knows the difficult situation we're in. You lived through this as when you were chief of staff. So I do appreciate your experience and your comments. And I commiserate with them. I agree with you that we need to work through some things because we don't know what's coming. The only thing I will say is, in a best-case scenario, if we were able to tap the entirety of the money that's available to us, and I don't think we will as of right now unless Washington changes their mind, but if we could, in conjunction with the cuts that we've already done, and make no mistake, we have done quite a bit. Our expenses are trending much lower than even last year. So I have every expectation that we will have a natural surplus, I shouldn't say natural, created surplus or lapse, as it were, in our expenses of several million dollars, maybe 2 to 3, maybe a little bit more, depending on just how stringently we can hold the line. So that, in conjunction with all of that money, would put us much closer. And then the decision could be, do we want to utilize a couple million dollars in reserves in order to avoid some of the painful consequences that would come out? But I also agree with you that we can't rely on that and that we should be looking at our options. And we are.
Alderman Redpath.
You know, I've been on the city council since 1987. I can tell you that we've seen a lot of bad times, and not quite as bad as we've seen this time with the COVID thing, and obviously it's things that are out of our control. But if we don't have a plan presented to us, you have 11 people on this city council who have a lot of experience in management and that type of thing that can contribute to this. And I can tell you that there's so many other options that are not even being discussed that we need to get out on the table. That's all we're asking. I think Alderman Donlin hit it on the head that we got to get involved and help. Nobody wants to lay people off. I know the mayor don't want to lay anybody off, and nobody does. But we got to explore everything. There's a lot of different more options than what we're looking at. So let's please talk and communicate so we can all be involved in this, because it might be Doris Turner, it might be Joe McMinimum who comes up with an idea that we haven't been thinking about. We all need to be involved in discussions. Okay.
Right. And I think it's great. And I would welcome any ideas that anybody has. And I thought maybe a month ago, I hoped I said that. If I didn't, I apologize. But I know you all have an extensive experience and have been in a positions of government especially. So I value the knowledge that you all have. I welcome it. I would love for anyone to reach out and say, have you thought about this? If you want to reach out and just chat through some things, I'm more than happy and willing to do that. Office is open and phone is available. So if anybody's got any ideas, please give me a call and let's chat. I'd love to do it. And if there's something I haven't presented to the mayor, I'll take it right to him and say, hey, Alderman Redpath came up with this idea, or Alderman Donlin went through this and they did this. We should maybe consider this. More than happy to do that. Would love to do that, as a matter of fact.
Alderman Hanauer.
Thank you. And Bill, that, you know, obviously our concern is how this rolls into next year's budget. When do you start compiling next year's budget? And I guess you're going to have to go four different scenarios on that budget depending upon how we end up with this. I mean, because, you know, the thing about a rainy day fund is it's great if you use it, unless you use it and it rains the next day and you need it again. And that's my concern with using too much fund balance, because, you know, I don't see a big light at the end of the tunnel anytime soon. The potential of a vaccine is out there, but what if it doesn't come and we're dealing with this like it's like the flu? We're dealing with the flu, you know, never goes away. So I guess, you know, when will you start working on the budget for next year? Because I'm afraid it's gonna have to get trimmed down very, very much.
Typically, we would start in October. However, we're already starting to look at some things now. Now, we really aren't going to be in a position until we get the July numbers, and that will unfortunately be October before we get that, because it's really going to serve as our baseline for revenue going forward. We feel like July is the place we're going to be until there's a vaccine. We feel like you could see from month to month growth in activity and growth in activity as you went from April to May to June to July. What we've seen just anecdotally, and we talk about this, is it looks like August was similar to July. You know, you're in that phase four, and we kind of think we're at a point that's sort of plateau in terms of economic activity. Maybe it'll grow a little bit. Maybe it'll go down with schools and fall and all that, but at least give us a pretty good baseline to go forward. But as I mentioned earlier, we're already starting to look at it, talking about pensions, for instance, and a $1.7 million potential growth in that going into next year. So it's never been out of the back of our mind, which is sort of the reasons why I tried to preface both last month and this month that what I'm showing you is only for this fiscal year. And I agree with you 100%, Alderman, that the rainy day fund, if you totally empty it out this year or reduce it down to 8%, whatever the case may be, and then you have absolutely nothing to work with going into the budget. Ideally, what we're looking at, because this thing will drag on as you've articulated, is making moves this year that will flow into next year as well. Shared services that the mayor talks about is a prime example of that. If we can come up with some ideas for shared services, and that will flow into next year. And we know those ideas are working. And I've seen it in my own office with our accounts payable office and how we went from 6 down to 5, and now we're in a position to go down to 4 because of the efficiencies that we've been able to generate and the change in the processes across the entire city. So shared services does work, and it does. Now, is there going to be enough shared services to take care of the hole that we have? No. No, there won't. I don't see how. But it's certainly a component of several things that we are looking at and could do that will help all in conjunction with one another to fill the hole that we have. But certainly the things that we're looking at or the things we should be looking at are the things that we can start now that will carry over into next year. And unfortunately, as the mayor has pointed out all too many times and all too well, that probably or typically would involve personnel because it's the biggest part of the corporate fund budget. It's 80% plus. So. And some of that personnel includes things like pensions that we can't do anything about. So you've got to pay those. And that's the predicament that we're in, is trying to figure out. And I know Chief Winslow is a prime example. He's trying to figure out how to operate his police department with a lot less bodies right now. And he's doing it. He's probably not happy about it. I'm sure he's not happy about it. But that's the predicament that we're in. We don't want to go filling positions when we might have to turn around and lay off people or furlough people. Those are the difficult decisions that will have to be made. But those kinds of decisions would flow into the next year in the budget. So we'll continue to look at all of that and compile, and once we have a plan from the mayor and we implement it, then that'll just be one more piece of the puzzle for our budget going into next year.
Any other questions?
Okay, thank you very much. And again, I encourage anyone, if you've got any questions or want to chat, please give me a call.
I'll call you tomorrow.
Thank you. All right. I look forward to it. Thank you, Alderman.
And for the, we do have two speakers come up. If you would, not touch the podium. I forgot to direct Director McCarty, but Nate's going to wipe it off. So we appreciate it, Nate.
Other duties is assigned.
Nate does it all. So appreciate it.
Absolutely.
And if you would,
we all have to clean our own workstations,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we don't want any grievance.
I knew you were going to say it.
And if the speakers could wear their masks, we'd appreciate it. First up would be Bob Moore with regards to the 10 principles of the NAACP. If you state your name and address for the council, we'd appreciate it.
Can I touch the podium?
Yeah, we'll let you. Nate will take care of it afterwards.
I guess it's okay if I take my mask off?
No. Sure.
No?
No, who's you probably should no? Keep it on.
Keep it on?
You're good, yep. Thank you.
I have a pass out.
Okay.
You don't mind?
Thank you.
Ah, there they are. Call your attention to the monitor. Turn in the point. Turn in the page, and hopefully we will be able to get a few some of this, but I want to make a short presentation. I want to, first of all, I want to introduce two people that are with me tonight. Mr. Risa Haley, president of the NAACP, and Mr. Ed Brzezinski, who's the executive director of the Illinois Chiefs Association. They are here because of our partnership. Following the Ferguson incident in 2014, the Illinois Chiefs made an unusual proposal to the NAACP. They proposed that the two agencies jointly work together to address issues that continue to cause mistrust between the black community and the police. This was an unusual criminal justice initiative initiated by the Illinois Chiefs, designed to benefit the police and the black community. It was unusual because it had never, ever happened before. And out of this partnership that was forged, we have developed a dynamic set of shared principles designed to build trust between the black community and police departments statewide. And I must say that during a two-year period of time, we held hearings all across the state of Illinois with citizens and the police before we developed these principles. So we've had statewide input on these principles. Tonight, in my short time, I want to do three things. First, on behalf of the Illinois Chiefs and the NAACP, I want to ask your support in moving the 10 shared principles out of your committee as a whole that we ask the mayor to support. Hopefully, this can be accomplished in the next 2 or 3 weeks. Second, I want to show a couple of slides from the PowerPoint presentation on the 10 principles. Finally, I want to provide you with some very good reasons why you should move our independently developed shared principles out of committee as a whole and publicly adopt the principles to show the community that you value and support these historic principles. We are proud of our friend Chief Kenny Winslow for spearheading the signing of the principles by all police agencies in Sangamon County. However, I don't believe that Chief Winslow is a member of the elected legislative branch of our city government. And as a citizen, I have asked my alderman for his support. And as far as proposals being advanced by other groups, we urge you to keep ours separate because the principles approved by the board of the Illinois Chiefs and the NAACP, and they are not subject to any changes. The position that I passed out, or the position that we have for reason why you should bring those out of committee. Ooh.
Yeah, did you turn them on?
I'm doing something wrong here.
Okay, can you flip through them then? What page do you... She'll have to...
Oh, there we go. She'll have to do it?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go to number one. Principle number one says that we value life, and we do.
Yeah, we do.
We value life, and above all, that's what we value. Number two. Principle number two, the person should be treated with dignity and respect. And that's what we want people to do. We know all police officers don't do that. We know that our principles are not being completely adhered to at this point in time, but they are in the process. Number three, we reject discrimination towards any person. Number four, principle, we endorse the six pillars of the President's Task Force on the 21st Century. Number five, we endorse the four pillars of procedural justice. Number six, we endorse values inherent in community policing. Number seven, relationships. We all need relationships. This is where our President and President of Illinois Chief signed this principles at the old state capitol, a historic moment in the state of Illinois. Number eight, citizens need a better understanding of the law. We strongly encourage our citizens to become better understanding of the law. We've encouraged police departments to teach them. Number nine, we support diversity in police department and the law enforcement community. Now, I'm going to give Chief Winslow a big plug right now. Oh, since 2013, he has increased the black population in the police department over 125%. We are a shining example across the state for minority recruiting and minority retention at this point in time, a shining light. And so we want to be shining lights with these 10 principles as you consider them. We've always promoted Springfield as being the beacon that we wanted it to be. And so I will now turn my attention to the last one, number 10. You've heard so much about de-escalation training. Well, this is one that we really are pushing. And there's so much room that's there to work with that. But the training in that particular area, our principles covered just about everything that you can think of. It was well thought out. It was brought statewide attention was given to it, et cetera. So, how's my time?
You're all right.
2 minutes?
You're all right.
Okay, one last thing.
Yeah.
Why should you, as a city council, bring these things out of council and bring them before and have them indeed voted on and published by the city? You will join a statewide movement in which trust is being built one conversation at a time in Urbana, or Edwardsville, Kankakee, Collinsville, Macomb. We have just recently made presentations to all of those city councils in these cities, and they adopted them. They adopted them. And we are simply, we didn't really originally have city councils involved with this, but as the principles got nationwide, statewide, and worldwide, we had mayors calling us to say, we want to adopt these principles. And so that's kind of how the mayors across the state has gotten involved. But these principles can provide a framework for a conversation that you want to have about relationships with the police, treating everyone with dignity and respect, de-escalation, and much more. These are shared principles of mutual principles on which there are agreement only after months of candid conversation. So this is more than this is what the police need to do. This is how can we stay in the conversation, because we all are accountable. We all are accountable. Each one of you are accountable for what happens in your city. And we need you to support your police department. You need you to support their decision to sign these principles. You need to support your mayor for wanting to bring them forth. And finally, the police know that some minorities distrust the police, fear the police, hate the police. They have acknowledged this reality during this process. This response is not, do not need that way, but please let me be more than so that I can understand and address it. So, as I say, my person of being here is to ask your support. We ask your support to support these 10 shared principles. They were independently developed by the NAACP and the Illinois Chiefs, and they are just not subject to any changes. They are not subject to any changes. So, any questions, I'll be pleased to ask.
Any questions? Alderman Hanauer.
Yeah, this goes to you, Mayor. When I recall when the chief signed it, I thought we had a resolution that we backed that. I thought there was something that we did at that time when all the chiefs of police got together and signed that.
Yeah, not at that time, unless it was the same year that the
right around. Am I? Maybe.
We did the anti-hate resolution. that was aside from this. That was back. That was in 2017, I believe.
We did something.
When was this signed originally?
We just recognize it. I don't.
Like 2018.
2018, the original signing.
Right.
And we were waiting. We had started asking that it got before the City Council, mm-hmm. and I think you finally got it in a resolution form. So that's what we're waiting on.
I thought I remembered doing that, but
no, sir, it hadn't been done.
All right.
We would have known it.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thank you. And next is DSI, Lisa Clement-Stott.
Oh, that's okay.
If you can.
I will give it a shot.
Thank you. Yeah, the other one was scanned in as a PDF. That's why I couldn't use the clicker.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Lisa Clement-Stott, the Executive Director of Downtown Springfield, Inc., and I am joined tonight by our President of the Board, Brian Wojcicki. There's a lot of Wojcickis in the house tonight. I have to point out, since we're wearing masks at the podium, that this is a mask from Reverie Apparel downtown, and a lot of our downtown businesses do have masks, so if you need to refresh your stash, they're getting new ones in all the time. Thank you for having us tonight. We would like to discuss why the city's partnership with DSI is more important than ever. All right, let's see if I can... Aha! Like everyone... Our businesses are dealing with many challenges because of COVID. DSI has not billed our retail, bar, and restaurant members since March when this started, but we have provided them with an amazing level of service as demonstrated by these unsolicited emails. Our goal is to save as many downtown businesses as we can through information and programs. Right away when COVID hit, we prioritized activities directly increasing sales for existing businesses. And yes, I'm going to take a little bit of credit for the good numbers that Director McCarty talked about in May. These are some of the key things that we did. Oh, there's not one picture on that one. So the first on the left-hand side was a picture of the old Capitol Farmers Market. I think you all know that it's the largest event safely happening in the county. We have 3,000 shoppers visiting us every single week. We are launching a new touchless credit card that SNAP users can use instead of the tokens where you have many touches and they're going back and forth between the farmers and the SNAP users. And it's been very successful. County Health, just Sunday night when we had our mid-season market meeting, gave us huge kudos for how we are running that market. Secondly, we quickly did what we called the Shopbox promotion. That is an online promotion where we were trying to get businesses to package their goods together, and then DSI used our website to sell the goods because not all of our businesses were able to do online sales right away. So we were kind of a stopgap measure to try to help them get up to speed online. And then the third part, I think you probably know just as much as the farmers market. On behalf of the mayor and Public Works, we met with every single block downtown, and we organized their thoughts into a cohesive program that Public Works turned around in 24 hours so that we could hit phase three with tons of outdoor seating downtown. So that was one of the best efforts I think we've done in a while at the speed of time that we did it. In addition, we raised private funds at our annual dinner in January for our program Momentum on Main Street, which I'll talk about a little bit more in a second. And those funds are being used to make the areas look nicer. So Sherwin-Williams donated paint for the Jersey barriers. We had tons of college students, you know, safely painting those in the last couple of weeks. We'll be adding lights. We'll be adding more plants and other different things. Trying not to put the cost on the businesses themselves. Although, as you can see, a lot of our businesses have invested in a lot of outdoor seating. So we think that the planning for the recovery starts now. Downtown, we have a lot of challenges. We continue to manage a generational ownership change, and this has just been hastened by COVID. We all know about the businesses that closed in June, making their mid-year decision. These were businesses that were successful 20, 30, 40 years, so it's not like they didn't have a great track record. They were nearing retirement, and COVID made them make their decision faster. So just kind of telling you a little bit about what we have going on the economic development side. Right now, I would consider that we have more than 10 vacant buildings, but we have 10 vacant buildings that we're actively working on right now. This means we know what the property's owner's goals are. We know if they want to sell. We know if they want to lease. We know what the price is. We know if they will negotiate. We check in regularly with the realtors. We check in regularly with the owners. And we generally have a sense of the best use of the type of business or the type of property developer if they want to sell that we're looking for those buildings. Entrepreneurs, it's something that we can't talk about a lot. We can't name names, but we have what I would consider 8 interested businesses on an active list right now, wanting to come downtown, wanting to have a brick and mortar. What it means that we have them on our active list is that we've talked to them. We, depending on what they need, we've kind of triaged them. Do they need financing? Do they need a business plan with the SBDC? Do they need to go through the co-starters program with Innovate Springfield? Do they need a realtor? Do they need property ideas? You know, what do they need? I have to breathe. Okay. We also keep tabs on them. We help them from concept to their announcement. And also, we are actively seeking new entrepreneurs. For example, we sent out an email to our farmers market list. You know, that is a really great incubator. And 5 market vendors told us that they were ready to talk about brick and mortars. So we are actively soliciting people to consider brick and mortars. You know about our COVID wins that we've had out of momentum on Main Street. The Three Twigs announced that they are going to fill a 20-year vacancy downtown. But I guess I would say the real momentum win is our chair of our momentum committee, David Lee, has announced that they're going to renovate the old bank at 4th and Adams, which is a 30-plus year vacancy into the public market. And then we're also trying to work on the investor side. That's more of a sticky wicket. It takes a lot of work to figure out the best way to pool investor funds together for some of these downtown projects. So the funds that we raised at the annual dinner, we're spending a small amount of them to upgrade the outdoor downtown areas, like I mentioned. And then also, we're looking at updating economic development reports from 2012. You can't take a developer an outdated housing report from 2012. It's no good anymore. So somebody has to pay for these reports to be updated, and we're looking at that. One of the things I think is going to be really key coming out of COVID is what to do with these large buildings. We've been talking about it for years, but I think it's going to be even more imperative. How do we convert more of these buildings into housing? Since COVID started, this is one of the 3 grants that we have won. DSI and the Heritage Foundation won a grant, and the outcome will be 3 vacant upper stories will have pro formas and other materials they need to move forward with turning their information into reality. And then we will have a playbook for all of the other property owners in downtown, and they will be able to use this playbook to potentially convert their vacant upper stories into residential. So that's definitely something that we have been working on the last few months. So, you know, especially during this time, always, but especially during this time, we are launching the only new programs that we want to talk about, that we're thinking about, that we're working on, are to increase spending at locally owned businesses. So starting this Thursday, we're going to be hosting weekly cash mobs at noon on Facebook Live. We're going to be inside an individual business, and we're going to be inviting dozens of people to come online and shop at that store. A cash mob is like a flash mob, but for boosting sales at a local business. Rep the City is a program that we put on hold since the COVID numbers went up. That is a program targeted to people 25 years old and younger. We had created small little events of 5 people and under for them to take their friends and experience a business. For example, they could sign up through an online system, and they could sign up for Linda Renahan of Springfield Vintage to dress them, and then we'd have a photographer there for them to take pictures, and they could post on Instagram. So trying to attract a younger audience. We're also going to be launching an architecture scavenger hunt since we have canceled our architecture walking tours for this year. Our sponsors are helping us. We're going to be giving $5 downtown bucks to participants that they can spend in our local businesses. And as always, Holiday Walks is around the corner, and we are going to figure out how to get our share of holiday spending downtown and safely. We're going to do that safely. So next year's right around the corner. So close. So we canceled Love It Amp this year because it just seemed like an insurmountable thing to organize with everything changing so rapidly. I just want to point out that DSI's staff donate their time to organize this free series. We raised $70,000 in private donations and $100,000 in in-kind support to pull this free 10-week series off. The middle point is about that we are constantly looking for grant funding and applying for it, and we won $21,000 worth of grant funding just the last few months. And then we'll start on our Momentum on Main Street networking again next year. We'll restart our networking and free classes, including a series on property development to accelerate matchmaking. So how do we move forward together? You know, we believe, and I think you probably do too, that we have gone above and beyond during the crisis. We are a great ROI for the city. For the city's $50,000 a year, we raise six times that amount and spend it downtown. It's a program, it's projects that you can be proud of, that you can take credit for. And we know, though, that you are in a period of having to make really difficult decisions. You don't have the full picture either. I just also want to point out that we are the smallest economic development contract. 100% of what you provide for DSI is invested right back into Springfield. 100% you can see with your own eyes. You know where it goes. You can drive down the block and you see what we do. You definitely have tough decisions to make, but I do also want you to know that when Director Yazel went through her budget cuts, DSI's funding did make it through her 10% exercise. And that's all we have for tonight. I really appreciate your consideration. I can't breathe. That's just what we're dealing with right now. But if Brian and I will be happy to answer any questions you have.
Any questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair will entertain a motion to dispense with the reading of the minutes of the August 4th, 2020 regular City Council meeting and approve the minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Chair will entertain a motion to incorporate the pre-council first reading of ordinances in the record of the City Council meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. The chair will entertain a motion to incorporate the pre-council reading of the consent agenda into the record of this City Council meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and second. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, vote aye. And those opposed, say nay. The
aye.
Clerk, pardon me?
You'll say aye. Just
okay. Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Chair will entertain a motion to place the consent agenda on final passage.
So moved.
Second.
Been moved and second. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, vote yes. Those opposed, vote no. The clerk will now call the roll.
Alderman Redpath.
Aye.
Alderman Gregory.
Aye.
Alderwoman Turner.
Yes.
Alderman Fulgenzi. Alderman Proctor.
Yes.
Alderwoman DeCenso.
Yes.
Alderman McMiniman.
Yes.
Alderwoman Connolly.
Yes.
Alderman Donlin.
Aye.
Alderman Hanauer.
Aye.
10 ayes and no nays, Mayor.
Thank you. Agenda number 2017-103, 2018-110, 2019-008, 2019-430, 2020-049, 2020-067, 2020-134, 2020-153, 2020-181, 2020-195, 2020-207, 2020-273, 2020-289, 2020-314, and 2020-315 remain tabled or in committee. Is there any motions on any of those? Chair will entertain a motion to add agenda number Item number 2020-335, an ordinance to increase the number of Class E liquor licenses by one for Hibachi Madness LLC, doing business as Hibachi Madness, located at 4318 Wabash Avenue, to the first reading of ordinances and to the record of this City Council meeting.
So moved. Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Aye. Motion carries.
Noted.
Chair will entertain a motion to add agenda number 2020-336, an ordinance authorizing the reallocation of existing budget authority for fiscal year 2020 for the Office of Public Utilities for first reading of ordinances in the record of the City Council meeting.
So moved.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Chair will entertain a motion to add agenda item number 2020-337, ordinance authorizing issuance of not to exceed $69 million water revenue bonds of the City of Springfield, Sangamon County, Illinois, for the purpose of making capital improvements to the water supply system, refunding certain outstanding water revenue bonds of the City, and amending the City's Water Revenue General Bond Ordinance to the first reading of ordinances in the record of the City Council meeting.
So moved.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Is there any unfinished business come before the council?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor.
Go ahead. Alderman Redpath, then Alderman McMenamin.
Go ahead, Joe. You can go first.
Just a point of order. I'm going from memory, but it seemed like we had three ordinances placed on debate last week. They were, I think, nominations to serve on the employee retirement advisory committee, and I think those, can we still vote on those if they weren't listed in the agenda, Corporation Council? We routinely put nominations to serve on boards and commissions on debate, and I think they were all three were put on debate a week ago. If we have to hold them for 2 weeks, I guess we could.
If they are not
on the agenda,
listed for debate, they are on the agenda as before the committee, correct?
Are they on the consent agenda?
No, last week they were put on debate agenda.
I would say ordinarily you would not be able to address something that is not on the agenda. However, because they are listed as items, you know, ordinances or resolutions tabled in committee, and the rules do allow you to remove an item with a two-thirds vote, you know, from committee.
I don't think they were tabled.
They were on debate.
They were motioned to be on debate.
But are they still listed on the agenda in committee?
No.
But if we moved them for debate, they should be on the debate agenda.
If we moved them for debate, they should be on this agenda.
Correct.
We will just carry them over to the next council meeting if that's the case. But we'll find out.
Did we act on them from 8-5?
We will have to find out.
Yeah.
So I don't see them on there.
Yeah, they are not on the agenda.
They were voted on.
Thank you. The last meeting.
2 weeks ago.
I think we had them, and there were 10 voting yeses.
Yeah, there were three appointments on the debate agenda last meeting.
That's what it was.
Okay. Those were 286, 287, and 288. And that was for Emmett Hill, John Smith, and Linda Dickerson.
Okay, I'll withdraw my comment then. If we've already voted on them, we can double check.
Yep. Thank you, Treasurer.
You're welcome.
Please start bringing that. Alderman Redpath.
Mayor, I understand that there's going to be ordinance brought forth on the Ferguson building downtown. I have some serious questions I'd like to ask on that, and I gave you a copy of the questions to the clerk. And at this time, I'd like to ask the clerk to please read those questions into the record, and I'd like to, for the administration to get back to me when you can on the answers, if you would, please.
Sure.
Okay, questions on Ferguson Building. Number one, ownership, entity, and banking reference on them. Number two, name and reference on the general contractor. Number three, total cost of project and development, pro forma, along with operating pro forma. What is the, number four, what is the current amount in the city TIF? Number five, will the unpaid bills to the local union subs be paid? Number six, will the TIF funds be paid as a reimbursement after evidence of the GC and developer have paid the bills? Number seven, are the pension benefits in arrears going to be paid? Number eight, does Mr. Lawrence have any connection to this project?
I know on the outstanding bills, Corporation Council could speak to it, but that was part of the developer's agreement. As far as the, I think the Associated Bank, the developers, all that information will be part of the packet that will go before the council, of course, and the EDC. But the other items, I think we'll have to find out as far as the balance of the TIF.
Can I give a copy of this to Corporation Council?
Sure.
I'll give it to you after.
We'll be able to provide, I mean, all of that information will be available.
You know, the thing about this is that everybody on this city council wants to see things thrive downtown Springfield, but we had a serious problem with this developer, and you all understand that, and we got to make sure that everything's clean and clear before we allow it to go forward. And as long as this developer's involved in it, it's not going to be clean and clear.
Yeah, a lot of the discussions were with a new developer.
And just briefly, one of the, Mayor, if you'd like,
yes, go ahead.
Just very briefly, one of the changes is that there would be no TIF money until the project's completely done. And one of the prerequisites is that all the prior bills, excuse me if you can't understand, but all the prior bills have to be paid, prior to any disbursement. And then also the TIF payments would be spread over a period of 8 or 10 years. So it's not a lump sum.
I appreciate that. I'll look forward.
But we'll be able to get a lot more information.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
No problem. Thank you, sir.
Alderman Hanauer.
Yeah, real quick. I guess my biggest concern is you're looking at $3.1 million. We've already put how much money we put toward this building already. And now we're going to put a lot of it to try to bail out a contractor that I think there might have been some shadiness going on because he didn't pay all the, I guess, prevailing wage is what he was supposed to pay, and because he didn't pay the benefit portions. And, you know, don't we have a max on what we can put in toward the building of downtown? Because it just seems like that this particular person keeps going around. He's saying he's going to re-energize this project. We've already put $1 million into it, so now you want to put another $3 million into it. That's $4 million in a building. I realize that some of these buildings are nice, but at some point in time, if they can't do it without the TIF money, chances are they're not going to get it done. They wouldn't be able to get it done with the TIF money. It's a little shaky. Myself, I'm you know, there's other projects that we know are you know, looking for TIF money. The public market is one of them. I think that's going to bring a lot more downtown than $2,500 apartments that, quite frankly, you're not going to get people to pay $2,500 for apartments downtown with no parking. I've talked to many developers around town. There's no market for it. Now, from a banker's standpoint, and you know, I have a hard time believing that a bank is going to give the money for something that is not going to be marketable.
But, you know, Ralph, it's not our business to be in their business. Our business is to make sure that what we're doing is protecting the taxpayers' money. And that's
right.
What this
we
is all about.
We got to treat this like a bank, though, and like we're the bank.
But if the bank wants to lend that person money, that's their business. Our business is to protect the taxpayers' money, and that's what we're here to
that's
do.
That's why I'm asking.
Yeah, so in answer to your question, with regards to the project, actually this administration put in the parameter of a third of the cost would be generated from the TIF. Where before it was, you know,
who knows what. With that, I believe the project, the end project's $15 million. Is that correct? I'm going from memory. But all these details will come before the council after it's presented to the Economic Development Commission. And then some of the TIF will be generated, the proceeds will be generated from the tax increment generated from the project itself. So a lot of those details will be forthcoming before it comes before the City Council, of course. Alderwoman Conley, or Alderman Donlan, sorry, and then Alderwoman Conley.
Just real quick, Mayor, it's related. I asked 3 weeks ago for a copy of a report that gave us the updated numbers on the downtown TIF. Essentially, it was asking for the present balance, what's obligated, what's expected to come in, just to give us a flavor. And I know the report already exists because it's been around for years. We haven't received it. Can we get that right away?
Yeah, we can get it. I think, do you know what the hang-up was on that, Counselor?
Honestly, I'm not quite sure. We'll just have to check.
That's one of my questions.
There was projections that had been done, and then there were it's gotten really still it's been reviewed over the last probably week or two. But it'll be available long before this, you know, this comes to the council.
I think one of the items of discussion was with regard, or the concerns, I should say, was with regards to the TIF is the projections they were projecting out, you know, what the expenditures were instead of actual time. And so that's one of the items that are trying to take a look at that report. So there was a consensus with regards to how to interpret it. I mean, going back to Alderman Hanauer's, you know, it doesn't matter what your future's looking at. What's the money in the bank right now? And what's it look like? And then as we go forward, how's that going to be coming in and the expenditures being taken, you know, from that? And so that's really what we need to get to. So there's an apples-to-apples understanding with regards to the cash flow of the TIF.
Right, but John Rogers from the Office of Planning and Economic Development mm-hmm. has the report. It's already done. All he's got to do is push print. Mm-hmm. And it's been 3 weeks, and I think we've been patient. Just like to have the report, that's all.
Sure. It'd be his interpretation, just so you understand. You know, with the
John's very conservative
with regards
with
to those
numbers. I mean, he always has
Well, they show the, we'll use the hotel project. Hotel project, $400,000 outside the TIF right now. Well, that hotel project's not moved. My estimation, it's not going to move. They have to come back before the EDC to give another presentation because the parameters have changed. And so that $400,000, of course, was accumulated already, like you've already spent it. That's not the case because you'd had to take actionable steps. So it's obligated with regards to that. So if you want the, so we can have them print it, send it out with regards to that. But there will be, I don't want someone going back to that. Well, we'll just have to explain it.
Yeah.
Here's what this report shows. Here's what we're seeing now. What's the difference? So we'll just have to go through that,
I think that
exercise.
Mayor, I think that example is a fair example because we get asked that question all the time. Is it still going? Mm-hmm. Is it not going on
right.
the project? But, you know, if it was on there obligated, I mean, we could obviously mm-hmm. at least
sure.
know that it may not be. But it is itemized, so I just appreciate it. Thank you.
And what will be coming before the council is we did put out for bid. It's good timing with regards to the future revenue generation of the TIF and taking out a loan with regards to that. So we'll have that information probably, I think, the week of the 24th. And so that will tell us if we want to borrow against the future earnings of the TIF, we'd be able to you know, borrow up to $7 million or whatever the case may be at a certain interest rate, and that will allow those revenue sources to be used today as opposed to waiting till the end of the TIF. As we know, that's then you're kind of racing to spend the funds. As Alderman Hanauer pointed out, there's projects now that need funding, and now's the time if we have the opportunity to fund something, we should try to do that. So that information will also be forthcoming probably the same time this information is coming forward. Alderwoman Conley.
Thank you. Actually, Alderman Donilon asked the first half of my question, so I'll be short. What is the timeline for us getting information on this this new the completion of the project that Alderman Redpath brought up?
I think it goes before the EDC on the 24th. Is that correct?
Okay.
So I asked them to try to.
I believe that's correct.
Get that to us, hopefully, the end of this week.
So when will that come before council for a review?
Well, it goes before the EDC, but as soon as they get the information, we can get that to you. But it will come before the city council, or the next committee as a whole meeting, so it'll be next Tuesday. And then the first vote or action taken by council will be the first Tuesday of September.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Alderman Proctor.
Then I would just ask anybody from Chesterfield, Faring, whatever, to talk to the home alderman about this project, because I have not been brought up to speed on what their plan is and on this thing. So until that happens, I would request this to stay in committee until
I get up. Yeah, we'll have them contact you and sit down and talk to you.
That would be great. Thank
you.
And
go over it. I think they're still pulling everything together with regards to tax credits, things of that nature, but Corporation Council's been in touch with them with regards to the technical items associated with it. Is there anything you'd like to share on that?
No, I believe that their thought is they will be here in person on the 24th and then also the council meeting. And so they are a separate company and a different developer, and they do have substantial resources of their own. So they are of the view, at least to what they've advised us, that they believe that they can make the project work based on what their, you know, their equity injection, the combination of the TIF, tax credits, and then also potentially using PACE as another loan source. So there's a combination of elements, but they will be here to, you know, talk about it and talk it through.
Well, we'll be sure to get in contact with you. Alderman Redpath.
Corporation Council, have we referred this case on the missing money for the pension benefits to the Department of Labor or the Illinois Attorney General's office?
It is my understanding that the when you say missing money, you mean the unpaid funds or unpaid, the bills that weren't paid. It was my understanding that the various either businesses or unions involved did that. It's not owed to the city.
Okay, it's not our responsibility to make that recommendation.
In other words, my understanding is there's, for example, lawsuits filed. I know there's various groups of lawyers involved from different parties involved in it. I think there are liens. It is my understanding there are liens on the property related to the claims, property liens. So I believe all the proper steps they feel is necessary to collect, you know, is in process.
But wouldn't we have an interest if our TIF money has been used and taken out of where it was supposed to be spent by spending it someplace else?
Well, there's no, I think the issue is not where it was spent, it's what wasn't paid.
Right.
And I think the bank, do you recall there was an original bank with the original developer? I believe that they did an audit of all of the spending, and very fortunately, the city cut off any funding once the bank indicated the problem. So I believe that they did, it is my recollection, it's been a couple of 3 years ago, but I believe the bank in question actually did an audit and to verify where the funds, you know, where the funds were actually spent. But I don't think there's a dispute. I remember seeing a list. I don't think there's a dispute of what the unpaid bills are. I don't think there's a dispute that the work was done or that the bills are owed.
So you're confident that city money has not been misused?
Well, I don't think the approximately $1 million that the city was reimbursed bills, our files show, you know, all of the proper invoices and so on. It's quite thick and quite extensive.
You know, when they bring a project to us and ask for TIF money, they put together a developer's agreement in which the developer needs to follow. And then, if I recall, didn't this contractor change his scope of his project halfway through the project to, it was what put him in the financial situation that he was in? And isn't that a violation of our rules?
I would have to go back and refresh my memory on everything, but it is my general memory that, yes, I believe there was a change in scope of work, and that was done without what I would call the proper approval process. I believe the bank in question felt that's what happened. There were meetings with the bank and the bank attorneys and so on at different times through that process. And the bank believed that there was a change in what the original plan was to what the bank funded.
In answer to your question, he was building out an elevator in between the two buildings. So he went out of scope. It wasn't shared with the bank that he was doing business with. And so they essentially cut him off. I mean, they cut off any funds coming forward, even though he had, at that time, financial resources at the bank. And so they were looking after their own self-interest, and that's what banks do. And so right now, in answer to the other question, those were all TIF-eligible expenses. So Abby could give an update when it does come forward with regards to that, because she's like a hawk when it comes to that, because those were reimbursable expenses. And some of the work had been done. So moving forward, you know, I think someone asked about the lender. I call it the lender of last resort. They bought out the bank in Quincy. And so they're very, you know, they're interested in getting it done. The change, in my understanding of the project from a couple changes that should be noted. One, the previous one had a lot of commercial space in it. This would be more residential. And the other side of it is it's not going to be, it's my understanding, I don't think it's the 2,400. I think it's well below 2,000 for the monthly rent. So it's not that scope since you're having more residential units. But all that information still will be forthcoming. You know, we don't have it as
there
far as that goes.
It will not be that central building.
They eliminated the elevator.
All right, I look forward just to, if you'll answer my questions, sure. I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
After we get them to Alderman Proctor.
Mayor,
call you up this week.
Mayor, can we have a point of order, please? Could we get this gentleman to sit down? He's been walking around the whole time we've been business.
Okay. Thank Alderman you. Turner?
I have two questions. One, since we're talking about TIF, I would really like to know what the status of the, in terms of balance for the Far East TIF now that it's been expanded. And is there any relationship between the Far East TIF and the Madison TIF?
Yeah, the Far East TIF and the boundaries of the Madison Park Place, they do touch. And so with that, you'd be able to use the funds within the Far East TIF from the Madison Park Place.
So
I don't think it encompasses it. I'd have to check.
Yeah, I think
it
border,
touches
but
it.
They don't.
Right. I think
it's not surrounded.
It's not. Okay. So they would. So those fund balances would be separate and not be able to be used.
No, you can port them. They call it porting. You can port those into a adjacent TIF that touches boundaries.
So what
that's the reason to run the reason that's we expanded the boundaries and had it run up to the
right,
Madison Park Place.
Right. That's what I thought. That I just wanted to make sure that my recollection was correct.
Yep.
Then my second question is there any intention or any plan to port any money to either of those TIFs?
As far as the plan coming forward, not as of yet, but there will be, I'm sure.
Okay, to do what?
Well, I'm sure there'll be housing plans or projects or business projects. I mean, the boundaries of the TIF. So if there's a project that comes forward with a developer or otherwise, we'd be able to have that figure into the equation. But nobody's come forward with a project of that magnitude as of yet.
Okay, that was my question because I keep hearing all these rumors and I'm always the last to know, so I just wanted to know.
Sometimes I am too.
Yeah. So my second question is, what is the timeline for the rolling out the rental assistance and micro business grant, not micro business loan, but micro business grant programs?
On the rental assistance, Val's working on that, and I believe it could be this week with regards to that. She was hoping to have it possibly as early as tomorrow, but we'll have to verify that. She was working on last-minute agreements with regards to the Urban League, but they're pretty close to having that wrapped up. With regards to the business one, that has gone up to the D.C., Washington, D.C. HUD. Because it's unique of what we're trying to do is leverage funds
to get more dollars into it from private to, or the, from the banking community to loan those out. So that's something that's unique to HUD. I don't think they were quite understanding or have never experienced that before, so that's taken a little more time than expected.
So what I'm hearing you say is that in the beginning I thought there was a micro business grant program and there was a micro business loan program. So now you're saying that you have co-joined those two and there's one program?
No, the grant program would be separate from the loan program.
So why did that have to go back up?
But it's through Justine Peterson.
So why did that have to go back up to HUD?
On that, I'd have to check with Director Yazel on that one.
Okay, because if they're separate, it's my understanding that the plan for the funds had already been approved by HUD, and that we were just waiting to roll that out. So
that was my understanding too. I wish it was that easy, but unfortunately, it's not.
Why?
And
why? I mean, that's my question. Why?
Right. Well, if we go way back when. Let's go back way back when, because really this is the frustration with HUD. It's emergency funds, and this is not like a tornado. And so in reality, when you have those funds available, you should be getting them to the distressed individuals, distressed by business, rental assistance, whatever the case may be. But we've gone through this arduous process, and they've treated it almost like community development block grant funds that you have to go through your regular planning process. And that's the frustration in all. So while individuals are, you know, dying on the vine, needing funds, we have to go through this rigorous process to get approval.
Okay,
and, you know, so in reality, that's unfortunate because it should just be how fast can you get the money into the hands of those that need it and move forward in that.
Okay, but not to cut you off, but it was my understanding several weeks ago that the plan for the rental assistance and the micro business mm-hmm. grant programs had been vetted by HUD, had been approved, and we were just waiting for agreements to be signed in order to roll the money out. So I'm not understanding why we would have to go, if that had already been approved, why it would have to go back to HUD for some different approval, unless we in some way co-joined the loan program and the grant program.
Yeah, no, that's not the case.
Sold it as one program.
Yeah, no, Director Yazel will have to give an update. She just sent an email. I'll send it to everybody. She says, well, this is why it took so long for HUD. And, yeah, I'll send it out to you. It's not the clearest.
Okay.
And we just received that this week.
Okay, it's my understanding that we approved three separate programs.
Correct.
Rental assistance, the micro business loan, and the micro business grant. And we did not, it wasn't my understanding that the loan program and the grant program were going to be co-joined and one would be held up and the one that had already been approved would be held up because we're trying to do this other loan program. So,
yeah, no, they're separate programs, but Director Yazel will have to provide the information with regards to dealing with HUD.
Okay.
That's what it comes down to.
Okie dokie.
So that's the frustrating part. Any other unfinished business? I do have one that, any new business, I guess. Alderwoman DeCenzo.
Yes, thank you, Mayor.
Uh-huh.
I had a constituent fall in an open water meter and suffer some injuries. And then someone in Leland Grove also called and told me that her child fell in an open water meter. Since this happened, they have been, well, one of the first victim of the water meter.
And where was this at?
This was on 3rd and Skerritt. So now she's going around town. She's found several open water meters. She's found several loose water meters. I think some people here know who I'm talking about. But she was injured, and this is a problem. So I don't know what we need to do with these water meters, because I believe they're all scanned now.
Yeah, not all of them.
Okay, well, these were, because the ones that she called about, they said, we have no idea why those lids would even be loose, because they're, we can scan them from the street. Mm-hmm. So something needs to be done about that. It's a danger. If a child falls in and breaks a leg, that's on us, and it's not cool. Second, today I had some residents on 9th Street contact me that they had no water. There was a water main. They were working on the water on 6th Street associated with the rail improvement project, and then a water main broke, and they didn't have water, and they weren't notified. Then they went and looked a little further on their porches, and there was a door hanger, like, shoved under a mat or something. So all afternoon, I'm getting tons of phone calls about people who don't have any water. So we need to do a better job.
I don't know if Doug Brown's here. I don't know if you could speak to the water main issue and then the water meter. I think as far as any claims of any individual being injured like that, would that falls in the lap of Corporation Council. But if you'd speak to the water meters as far as, you know, reporting them, and then also with regards to the water break or not having water on 9th Street.
Yeah, I mean, if there's anybody that sees a water meter covered that's not covered, if they would want to call in that to the water department, we'll take care of that. I'll talk to the water department and find out why there's an issue, if there's been that many that are been uncovered. So
she's now going around town taking pictures of them and posting them on social media. So it's not an isolated incident.
Yeah, I think I know maybe the individual that mentioned something to me.
Are they turning it in?
Oh, yes.
Good. We appreciate
it. It was more of the initial one, I think, that she had mentioned that I just had met with her.
Yeah.
And then as far as the water main goes, I didn't know of the incident, but I'll talk to the water department about that.
Okay. With more people home, it's an issue. If they plan on, you know, watering their garden or making a meal or flushing the toilet, it's kind of a problem.
No doubt.
Right.
Water is the resource of the future, right, Doug?
Yes,
Alderwoman Turner.
So, since I know we had this whole conversation a couple of weeks ago about the increase in the CWLP bills, so is there are people still reading the meters, or is there an increase in estimation of the meters?
Doug's ready to tackle it, because this flows right through to the sanitary district billing.
They said it doesn't.
No, it does. It does. And the reason being is someone showed me their bill. It had 14 meters one month. Next month was 21 meters or whatever it is, and that's why their bill went up significantly.
Yeah, I mean, so if somebody has, like, a water leak, their bill could go up.
No, I understand that. But what I'm saying is that people are saying that they have not seen meter readers reading their meters. So is there a higher estimation of?
Well, it depends. Some of the routes are automatic, so they just have somebody drive by and they can read the meter on some of them. There's other ones that they do have to still
so can you, many can you, to read. Can you let me know which routes are automatic? I mean, you don't have to do it right now, but
sure.
If you could let me know.
Yeah, I can look at that, yeah.
That would be great.
Mm-hmm.
I actually haven't seen a meter reader.
Mine is. Mine's not about it.
Yeah, I think there's something going on.
My bill is way too high.
There's something going on.
I think 25% of the meters are on the automatic read. Is that correct, Doug? 25%?
It might be about that.
Yeah. And so we are going to determine how to switch them all over. You brought up a good point, is how do you get them all to the electronic meter reading? Because by doing that, what it does, it notifies individuals when, if you have the new system, it will notify individuals when there's usage is going up. Like the example I used, if it's out of the norm, then it notifies CWLP or the customer with relation to that. So that's one of those smart city initiatives that we're looking at. Of course, it comes down to money. Yep.
Okay. Yeah, if you could just let me know that.
I will. I'll look at that, and I'll find out if there's any issues with, like, maybe some meter readers have been out or something like that, too. So
okay,
I'll
thank
find
you.
Out.
Thanks, Doug. I do have a new business. One was brought up by Alderman Fulgenzi. If you haven't done so, if you go down 9th Street or to Peoria Road, the viaduct there is painted. And so we know many things were canceled and postponed this year due to COVID-19. However, there are organizations that have been working through COVID and finding new ways to continue their programs. Wanted to give special thank you to Betsy Dollar and the Springfield Art Association for continuing their artification, beautification projects in our city. Special shout out goes to Aaron Svensson, who organizes many of their summer art camps. A few years ago, Aaron coordinated with the Springfield Art Association digital art students, the Futuristic Springfield, displayed on the windows on the south side of the Lincoln Library. Their teen camps also did the bicentennial mural along the Clear Lake Avenue. If you've seen the that wall there, it's on the north side. This year, the high school camp took on historic Route 66 and painted a vibrant mural under the 9th Street Viaduct north of Converse. They not only painted the mural, but they also painted over graffiti and primed the area, weed whacked, picked up litter, and even mowed. The Springfield Art Association and their staff artists and volunteers have done numerous things around our city, especially downtown. They are also continuing it to plan for projects in the future. We are grateful for their partnership and appreciate everything they do and bring to the community. So appreciate that special recognition on behalf of John Fulgenzi, but they have done the great work associated with that. And then Public Works actually said that they're going to take care of the railing, right? The railing was a little rusted, so that's on their list to do. The other one I'm going to share real quick is this is pretty interesting. It's a greeting card I received. It has Springfield on the front, and it reads, "Good morning. Time has come round," and this is in quotes, wrote Shakespeare, and indeed it has. And this comes from a gentleman from California. "I was at an antique store months ago and found this circa 1910 beautiful picture card from your city. I figure you and your friends might enjoy it. At any rate, I hope it brightens your day. The card is an old-time classic for sure. I said to myself, by golly, I think I'll send it to home where someone can appreciate it. Heritage is important to all of us. Post it up. It will create some nice conversation. Well, I gave $2.50 for it, so you want it for $3 or $4. Why would that be okay with me? Throw in a little postage if you want to. My wife used to say to me and laugh, if you hear from them, you'll have to take me out to lunch. I turned 92 years old on June 26th and still going strong as far as I know. I like to call my little hobby the redistribution of happiness. Our world sure needs it. Thank you, and I wish you folks all the very best." And it's signed by Lowell Jorg in Stockton, California. And he says, "P.S. Oh, yes, my daughter says you can find me on Google, but I never look." But it does have – what's interesting, it is it has Springfield, the capital S, is a – it's a kind of interesting. It's a homage to women. And then in this, the rest of it, it's pictures of children. So I thought it was perfect with the, especially the year of suffrage, you know, in honor of women. So, yeah,
isn't
that's
today,
pretty
today.
Amazing.
That was my new business thing,
yes.
I was going to say.
Today.
How about that?
Congratulations.
Righty
back.
That's karma.
That's karma.
Yep.
And I tore my white.
And so the other thing is, you know, bringing it down a notch, Facebook Live this Wednesday will be the discussion about elections. And Matt Dietrich from the Illinois State Board of Elections, Don Gray from Sangamon County, and then Frank Lesko will participate in that.
Can you ask him about the drop boxes?
Yeah, we will.
Thank you.
Who, Frank or Don? So, yep, very good. So the last presentation is John Fallon, and John is the outreach coordinator. I brought him in because of the situation we have with street homeless, especially the situation we're in. And right now, the United Way with the Land of Lincoln Foundation, the county and the city, and other partners are working on a long-term strategic plan to address the situation, which would include some fashion of the Center for Health and Housing, whatever that looks like. But in the interim, as we know, there's a population of individuals on the streets this summer, and how to address that. But as importantly, how do we address it as we're moving towards the wintertime and building that bridge with the long-term strategy. So John will show two short videos, kind of gets to the heart of what he wants to talk about, but there's more for introduction, then he'll meet with you one-on-one if you so choose and go from there. So this is John Fallon, and I don't know if you want to start with the, just do your introduction real quick, and then the videos, yeah, or how do you want to do it?
And then I'll tell you what, I'll in a second we'll talk about the video, but this is an, my name is John Fallon. I've been in the field for about 40 years. I started in Urbana, Illinois at Cunningham Children's Home. And so I know Central Illinois. I know this is Central Illinois, not Southern Illinois, even though I might have come from the northern part of the state where we can make sure that Packer fans stay on their side of Wisconsin. I live in Waukegan. But the mayor remembers me, and some of you may have been present a couple of years, I think, at this point, when CSH was here at the library talking about homelessness. And I happened to be talking to the mayor, and the mayor remembered me, and I was available and have always been interested for 20 years in trying to make sure that the city of Springfield uses supportive housing and those techniques because it reflects well on Springfield as well as on the state to have our state capital solve that problem in the right way. So that's my goal, and I'm happy to have the mayor. So. Yep. Do this.
We'll
so I'm going to distribute a card.
Yep.
And this is a 10-year-old video. That's what I will tell you. And some of you will hear about the Vulnerability Index or the VI-SPADAT nowadays. The VI-SPADAT is two tools. But this sort of explains to you 10 years ago. So this is not a new idea, but this is what needs to come to Springfield. And I'll give you my card, and I'm available to talk to you at any point.
Really, by listening to what other communities were doing, was that once the community had this data in person-specific, rank ordered by life or death, they started changing their systems. They knew that the status quo, the way that they were doing business, was going to result in those people being on the streets forever or being dead. Again and again, we find that there's people who really want to do something to solve homelessness, and they just don't know what to do. And your local campaign team is an opportunity to bring all those people to the table and give them something productive to do that literally results in knowing who your most vulnerable neighbors are and helping them get into housing and keep that housing. This is a team effort. There's no way we can house 100,000 most vulnerable people in this country without everybody being part of this team. We want to share the tools with you. We want to connect you with other people that are doing the same thing. All you need to do is go to our website, www.100khomes.org, connect, join, and be part of this movement. It's going to be pretty exciting. I think we're going to fundamentally alter forever the way that this country responds to street homelessness.
Within 3 years, CUCS, who's the organization in New York, and an approach called CST and Housing First, focused on those groups, housed 130,000 people across the country. They didn't do it with large places or anything else. They did it with a lot of volunteers, a lot of focus of uniting landlords, and a lot of flexibility within the housing authority, and a lot of support from, you know, you have, I mean, Springfield is very rich without even looking at homeless systems, with two hospitals, two federally qualified healthcare centers, a federal PATH team, all focused on street homelessness, in addition to, these are resources that other places don't have, and that you have three universities. All of those things make this a very strong community, and you have 50 or so people that are on the streets right now, and that should be the focus of the group, independent of whatever else we have in emergency housing. And a lot of those people that I've met on the street so far have been on the streets for a really long time, and that's sort of not what HUD has asked communities to do. And I'm not so sure that the homeless system has to fix that. This is about everyone working together with mainstream services that are there now, and there will be a long-term planning process. But the mayor's asked me to be involved in an interim process focused on those 50 individuals that are on the street that currently can be housed. And I have experience doing that, and I want to train the workforce here who's interested in that, in trying to do that, to try and take pressure off the idea that you have to have a warming center for the homeless and instead support people in housing. So I want to then show one more quick video, and this will seem like a boring video. I just want to tell you that right off the bat. That's a good way to begin this. But what I want to say about this video, hold on for just a second. Again, this is a 10-year-old video. But we normally think people should be grateful if they're given any housing at all. And this, you will see, will show the importance that people who are on the street really do want to get into housing if it's the housing they want, and they're given a choice and they think about it. And it's a different kind of approach than here's what you get and you have to like that or else. And so I want you to watch and to be thinking about what oftentimes people think about, which is people should be grateful for what's offered and what happens, and look at where this person was and where they end up. Go ahead now.
Building, been in building, and Del Carmen and friends. We did 9 surveys that morning.
Just with that group.
Yeah, just with that group. We had that one up more the next day, but her was one of the first people that we talked to. She and I got along real well, so I knew that she needed to get into a place. So we started coming up. We made sure to go back and find her and give her good news, see if she wanted to get into her pregnancy.
The body of the woman saw the green dog and said, "You must try to get me a place." And he's like, "Okay." And when I came back, he goes, "Well, did they?" He said, "I'll be in my life."
So that's a long way to come back to the real message, is that homeless people make decisions about housing the same way you and I do, and they want to be close to the house, and they want to be close to services, and it's an individual choice, and services for people need to be delivered individually and not as a giant group, and education and choice needs to be individualized, and it isn't a one-size-fits-all, and it and that in my time in Springfield, I drove all over the city to look at people in the various little tiny homes encampments,
It's too bad that the several homeless encampments have signed a kind of combined, but they're now resorting themselves out because communities form on the street, and the trick is to help to figure out how each of these individuals can fit into the local community and to make sure the healthcare support is there, and that this is a volunteer effort along with a real commitment, and that the amount of cost that it is to have people on the street is much larger than you realize in unreimbursed care at the hospital, when it could be reimbursed in different ways or the losses could be less, as well as the cost to have people. So I'm eager to work on this sort of interim plan to quickly get people into housing. And you have a lot of providers already united around this issue, and this is about raising the scores that they need to get more HUD money here in the future with goals this year, which then will assist in the long-term plan. So with that, I'll turn it back to the mayor, but I really appreciate the mayor allowing me to work here and your sense of urgency that this is something we need to fix now, and we need to more quickly approach it using existing resources while we gather together a longer-term plan for long-term resources. So thank you.
Any questions?
Question, Mr. Mayor.
Alderman McMenamin.
John, you mentioned just now that you're working on an interim plan. Could you describe what you mean by interim plan?
There is a long-term plan that the county and several, you know, most of the providers have been working together. The interim plan is just what are we going to do now with 50 people on the street? So what you just saw is what I would hope to do, that we can find Medicaid providers, which is what you need to be sustainable, mixed with affordable housing, and to raise that. And so I'm working closely with the mayor, and I'm happy to work with individual aldermen to understand what that is. And I view the city of Peoria as a model for how you do the kind of supportive housing that's necessary. And there are a lot of national models. Houston and other places where I've worked can help to bring some of those ideas. But immediately, the focus, Alderman, is to really push to house people right now. You know, you don't need a long time to train someone to live in housing and to slowly move them from place to place to place. They're pretty good at moving from place to place, and they're pretty good at eating in large groups, but those aren't skills that I have. I personally hated the cafeteria when I was in high school and in all the years before that, and I still hate it. I don't like to eat in the cafeteria. I like to eat by myself. And so that's what I do in my home. And when I go in, and, you know, to a restaurant, I sit in the corner. That's my alone time, and it should be. And so individually, we want to teach people the skills they need to live in the apartment, but we can teach them in that apartment rather than have them go through 25 programs beforehand and keep moving.
Okay, I think
figure
I get
out
the
what
idea.
They need.
I think you're saying that by interim plan, you mean a whatever comes into being before we have a long-term plan.
Correct.
I don't think you've got the specifics of an interim plan yet. Is that correct?
I don't have that, yes. Right. I'm working with the mayor to make those recommendations, and he'll bring them out as we do. But I think that there are available federal resources that could even be used now to make that work.
Thank you very much.
And actually what he's done is, I just said, go out there and meet the homeless individuals, the agencies, the sports agencies, and form his own opinion. And that's what he's been doing, is that one-on-one perspective, and then offering up recommendations associated with it, with the goal of housing people now or putting them into a support system of some type. And then really, what do you do in the winter with regards to the low barrier shelter or whatever the case may be, and that's what we're trying to do right now or prepare for, so we don't try to address it at the tail end. Alderwoman Conley.
Thank you, Mayor. I have a couple of questions, and the mayor kind of touched on it, so and actually so did Alderman McMenamin. So this interim plan, are you incorporating, I mean, what are we to expect? We've got a cooling center that has tents set up behind it, which is not a solution. We have a warming center that despite the best, I mean, the Salvation Army did, I think, they did their best to try to make that something that could work for us last year and on very short notice. I'm very concerned. I mean, I understand it's August. We all feel like we've got lots of time. November will be here around the corner. So, yeah. I don't know. You're talking about providers and money, and we can get people into apartments. How long are you going to be here? I understand you're on contract. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
How long are you going to be here? What sort of expectations do we have for this contract? What sort of a plan will we have in place? Are you finding someone to run this warming center for us? Because last year, I'm sure the mayor's told you, it was no small scramble to get a social service agency to come in and run that for us. So I guess, what are our expectations that as a council we can see? Because I will tell you, we had a solution last year. We had the Center for Health and Housing, and in my ward, I had more contact than I've had on any other issue with people supporting that concept, people wanting that to move forward. And that was that step to get resources for people. So if you're saying that we can get these resources to people in apartments or houses as they're spread throughout the town, what is our timeline for this?
Well, I mean, I'm not here to revisit that. I didn't know about that when I talked to...
I'm not talking about revisiting that. I'm talking about your plan specifically that you are on contract to do for us.
And so the answer is that I am very excited to be in Springfield. I think there's plenty of resources, existing resources now, to be able to house people if they're following long-term national evidence. And for anyone who needs it, I brought the federal plan to end homelessness, but it doesn't, there are large places to evaluate and everything else, but honestly, in community treatment, you don't really need a place to evaluate. You evaluate out of your car, and that's what I did for, 10 years. We did that at Thresholds and other mental health agencies. We got Medicaid reimbursements. So you need some money up front to get it started, and then after that, Division of Mental Health and other places pay for that. And the city of Springfield taxpayers are giving a lot of money to homelessness relative to other cities. And so I know this is not the kind of conversation yet that we're ready to have, because this is, the mayor has slowly been introducing me to various people so that I don't sort of get in that. But I will tell you that unreimbursed care to the two hospitals is really huge here and could be invested. That same money could be invested in other ways to get funding towards here. The state funding for a Division of Mental Health could be directed to case management. This is the only continuum in the state. It has continued to lose money the past 4 years than the reports from Springfield. It's not focused on housing people within 20 or 30 days, which is what the 10-year plan written, this is a 10-year plan, and places like Houston and other places have ended individuals who are single and homeless on the street. That's not the issue that the high-performing communities are working on. So my goal is, the same as what anyone else will plan on the long term, which is to have providers who go on the street, meet directly with people on the street, figure out what they need, don't have them go through 10 programs, but rather put them in housing. And instead of moving them from house to house, you vary the level of services. So initially you need a lot of services, then you pull back. And I wear glasses, and those glasses give me the ability to see. I don't need to, get rid of the glasses in order to live in the community. I have glasses to the right amount, and at first I might need a higher level of support. And so it's varying the level of support. And when we put people into housing, landlords need the support of the medical system to be able to make sure the housing doesn't go badly. And I have given the mayor suggestions for how to help the landlords to make sure and still hold them accountable. And there are things that housing authorities do across the country that aren't done here that all could be done. So this is a resource-rich area with existing. And a long-term plan will bring some new funding with some new ideas. And if I was working on a two-year plan, which I've been involved in those kinds of plans,
okay,
I would be working on. But short-term, 50 people is, in Chicago, it's called a Tuesday in terms of housing 50 people. And with two hospitals, two federally qualified health care centers, Rule 132, mental health provider, a federal PATH program as your mainstream resources, along with your own housing authority, a rental housing support program from the state, that you have the resources to house these 50 people. The question is how you prioritize, what you prioritize, and what the community is going to look at. So I housed people with hundreds of arrests and some people with hundreds of psychiatric hospitalizations. And we visited 7 days a week, 365 days, including holidays, with those individuals. And it was Medicaid-funded, and it works. And it's a program that's being done across the country and isn't happening. And so I'm right now staying at the Carpenter Hotel where I can see people on the street, and I go over and talk to them, and they're not more difficult to house than other people I've worked with in the past with less resources than the city of Springfield has right now. So you're going to be helping us
coordinate our resources because, I mean, obviously we had DSI.
I'm sorry, in what are resources?
So we had DSI here tonight, and they're still here, and mm-hmm. obviously one of the big issues that our downtown businesses face and that our visitors face is a strong presence of homeless population or people who are experiencing homelessness in our city. So mm-hmm. I guess what I'm asking is, are we going to be getting, like, we will be getting regular updates. We're going to be seeing some movement so that some of these people who are sleeping in doorways will be able to be transitioned. I mean, you said 20, 30 days. So are we looking at some 20, 30-day movement of our existing population?
I'm saying that high-performing communities already do that. I don't know if in the interim I can get it that fast, but I have a belief that if all the agencies work together, that you could get people housed before winter, all 50 of these individuals. I mean, I honestly believe that. But if everyone remains in silos or focused on huge long-term projects, then you get stuck. Since 1984, HUD has said we don't want the HUD money to be used for anything but housing. And I was in the field in 1984, so I remember that. That's long before we talked about 10-year plans, which were 20 years ago or 25 years ago at this point. And it's 10 years since this plan. And it's about, you got to just start. You got to have people committed to housing people. And so I did talk as soon as I stepped out. So sorry, Alderman, I was one of those people moving in and out of the room. But it was to talk with downtown Springfield. Because, the fact is there is a concentration of people who've been there a long time, and you can talk with them about where they were. And there's actually several different concentrations. But there's also concentrations of people out in the shopping centers.
Yeah.
There's people on South Grand Avenue. And the idea isn't to bring them all into the center to then get housing. You got to meet them where they are, which is in all of Springfield, not just downtown. And then you have to start getting people into housing right away. And you don't need a lot of stuff. You need a place where people go if they're really in tough shape for emergencies, but that's a relatively short period of time. Emergencies are maybe 2 weeks, not 5 years, and on the street. And if you look at the woman that you just saw in the last part, she was very thoughtful about where she wanted to live, why she wanted to live there. It isn't putting everyone in one neighborhood, it's figuring out what neighborhood works for them and why. And so there's reasons why there's encampments, small little tiny encampments of people, three or four people here and there. It's because there's something about that area that works for them. And so it would make sense to get them into housing where they want to live, not where we decided they should live. And we shouldn't be putting people always in the same place. We should be putting them where they want to be. And we should be providing the support that they need, because once they get into housing, guess what? We're going to discover that they have diabetes. We're going to discover that they have foot illnesses. So they're going to need that nursing support where you're like, oh, man, we'll have to get a doctor. No, doctors are paid for under the Affordable Care Act if you access it right, and they're paid an extra amount in the federally qualified health care center. And if you have a relationship with those individuals that you form by meeting them on the street, you know, I'm a little afraid while I'm here in Springfield that I will get arrested for having, you know, being a person who's laying and sitting in the parkways because I'm sitting next to those individuals and finding out what they might want to do. And they have fairly rational plans. Are they going to blow up? Maybe. Maybe they might have to move a couple times, you know, if it doesn't work out. And so then you have to have a strong relationship with landlords as you work on that, because they will figure out those things. But I will tell you that the folks that I worked with got into housing and stayed in the housing, and they had 80% reductions in hospital time, hospitalizations, arrests, and days in jail. And I did that very consistently. And then for the last 13 years, I've been training other communities to do that and individual programs to do that. And the program that I ran got the top national award. So I sent the mayor my resume, and so you can go through the resume. You can see professional articles I wrote and everything else. I would love, you just need to hear, in 4 months to find the right people who are really invested in this, put them around this problem and house these 50 individuals and keep them in housing, which will require a lot of support from the business community, the landlords, but in a different way. And we will support people as they are housed instead of as they are homeless.
And that's wonderful. And the goal will be to serve
all of Springfield and not just small parts. I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to say, I thank you very much. I'm sure we have, I know that we have some interested people who, especially in the landlord association. So if you haven't already reached out to them, I would encourage.
Which is that the?
I'll give you a call tomorrow. How's that?
Oh, okay. I actually have a meeting with them coming up because that was one of the groups that I wanted to talk to, and I'm working with the mayor on those. But I welcome anything you could say and you can talk about me. But I honestly would love from a person who works statewide on this issue. I'm on the NAMI Illinois National Alliance for Mental Illness board. Making sure our state capital is a model of this is really important, and being able to see so many people on the street is not a look that I like to see our state legislators see. So I really look forward to making it a model program.
I certainly hope you're successful. I really okay. do. This is an issue that is critically important, and I certainly hope you're successful. So I'll be in touch. I've got your number now, so you're going to
okay. And I me. Pick up that cell phone. I'm here Monday through Thursday usually, and then Friday I go home, but I'll still be available
okay,
to everyone.
Wonderful. Thank you.
And anytime you want to call. And I'm not being confrontational. I just love this stuff.
No, it's and, I appreciate
yeah.
the information. Thank you.
I mean,
you.
The mayor tells me to shut up, but I don't do a very good job of it.
Any other questions?
No. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, John.
Okay, thank you.
Nate's going to take care of the podium real quick.
Good job, Robert.
Next is Marky Surratt. Marky Surratt. Nate's going to take care of the podium real quick.
Mayor.
Thank you.
City Hall.
Thanks,
I apologize
Nate.
For our breakfast, your ability.
If you'd state your name and address for the council, we'd appreciate it.
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Marky Surratt. And I'm temporarily a resident of Springfield, and I want to address the issue about homelessness first. But I heard a comment earlier about the police, and I want to share something with you guys. I've lived in Seattle, Los Angeles, Champaign, Urbana. Those police officers here in this town, they're very cordial. They're very cordial, okay? And I think they have the utmost respect. And they've caught me, listen, four or five times a day, you have to call the medic units for the homeless and the police. And they keep catching me cleaning up and stuff, and they told me, thank you. And these officers, over to you, they don't make a difference. They don't care what color I am. I believe they're the best. I've never seen the finest. I will say that. And this is the capital here. This city is number one. You've got to get it together. But I just want to share something with the homeless, if I may. I've slept with, I'm homeless because I had a stroke a month ago. And then I got a respiratory problem. There's another viral out there, and we can't figure out what it is. And then I got mugged and clubbed. I got broken ribs and broken clavicle. And so I work for DVS. I work for AA Cleaning. I can't go to work. I'm not physically capable. So I had to lay in the streets. It's hard. It's sad. So every day my mom wires me $50. But what I was doing was, I'll be honest with you, you know, I was buying the guys alcohol and cigarettes. And so at 7 in the morning, I got to have it. Now, I was staying with white male population, okay? And the black guys told me that you shouldn't be with them. But I was comfortable with them. And I was trying to bring us together because there's a lot of friction in the city. With the blacks, with the whites, it don't make any sense. And you got the homeless stealing from each other. You've got a dollar, I'm going to steal it from you. That doesn't make any sense. And so I share. I share every day. But I finally decided 2 days ago to quit buying red alcohol. I've got to clean myself up too. You know, I'm sick. But what I've seen out there, every day they're fighting. And following the heads. I called the medic unit like 5-6 times. All the police know me. Pretty much they know me. And I'm trying to help the city. They catch me cleaning the streets. I clean from Carpenter to Madison. I pick up all the litter, go to Lincoln Museum. I pick that all up. That's just because I want to work so bad. But the problem is, you got these guys in wheelchairs with no, they double amputees. I have to pick them up in their wheelchairs. These guys are drunk. They fall on their heads. I take care of them. And then I said, look, they defecate on the properties, urinate. You can't do that. Go, you know, there's not enough outdoor houses. I told them, look, what can we do? Some of them don't even want to work. I've worked for 55 years. I make $89,000 a month. Right now, I'm at zero. But I'm going to make it. And what I'm simply saying is, the homeless, they get displaced from here and there and there. There's the church over there, Cuba Church. Where else? The Bread Line. And, you know, the people keep saying, you can't stay there. And then I was in the tent city last night, and they was fighting every night. But last night I was there, I kept the peace. I'm a mediator. And what we need to do is figure out how, not everybody's on drugs and alcohol. A lot of them have some medical problems. A lot of them have some mental problems. And here's what I see. I see a waste of state money because they out in those streets. If we had like we had on the West Coast, we had a medical program where you came out and visited them, they can come in and don't worry about it. And what I'm saying is you can save thousands and thousands of dollars. You can. Pretty much all, both hospitals know me well. They know what I do. And I've looked out for those people and the homeless. It's sad. It's sad. It makes me cry. And I'm temporarily here. I've got property everywhere. But I'm here for a reason. I'm gonna explain why. But my time is coming up. But I help these guys as best as I can. And they've lost all their hope in their life. If I can get them some social work, some mental help. It's more medical, though. It's mostly a lot of medical. Yes, there's a lot of drinking. A lot of them don't do drugs. They just drink the alcohol. And they drink the cheapest beer, the cheapest vodka, and roll the cigarettes. So their lungs are bad. Their livers are gone. And it's going to just cost the state in the long run. If we could find a way to remedy that, we might can get ahead. I bring them clothes. I go get them socks. I get them pants. I pick them up. I wash them off. That's what I give back to my community because I'm here. My goal is to keep this city clean. I'm welcome here. I'm here. I take up garbage everywhere. I take up everybody. I am not prejudiced. Yep. Not at all.
If you haven't done so, if you'd give your information to John, we appreciate the work that you do, and we can help with regards to that, and he'll offer additional recommendations.
All right. Well, I just
have you met John?
Mm-hmm. The police officers are probably the finest. I'm going to be honest with you.
Thank you.
I run into him all day. Didn't know me well. And, you know, we got this issue nationwide, Black Lives Matter, whatever have you. They are very diplomatic. They take the time and explain the situation. I will tell you this. I don't know the police chief. But I'm pissed. These officers here, they probably the finest.
Well, thank you.
I'm going to let you know that.
Appreciate it.
Okay? And now, I just want to thank you, city, for letting me be here. I have no more to say.
Thank you.
Good day.
Have a good day.
All right.
Next is John Clem. Thanks, Nate. You're doing an awesome job. Yeah. Appreciate it.
Is other duties as assigned, Nate?
It is.
Other duties as assigned.
Hey, John.
Don't touch a podium,
thank you.
John.
My name is John Clem. I live at 2305 Terror Lane here in Springfield. Just about the time I don't think I can get surprised by the city. 2 hours before I'm going to come to this, I get two emails. Good news is the stuff has expired, so we won't have to spend any time on it. You won't remember a vote that you made, but in March the 3rd of 2019, the council voted 10 to nothing to approve an amendment that would get it so that we would either be able to get some work done or that we would get our money back, because we still have money even though we did clean up the developer's agreement, because that thing was totally out of hand. But council, like I said, approved it 10 to nothing. 18 months later, right now, nothing has happened. And the amendment that was created by the city, I'm going to read two parts of it to you. The work described in this attached exhibit shall be performed by the city of Springfield and shall be completed within 1 year of the effective date of the amendment. So that would have been this past March the 19th. The other sentence is, in the event that the Cockrell Lane improvements are not completed as provided, the owner shall be entitled to a full refund of the amount the owner paid on the cost of improvements. In my case, I paid $31,805. I am also here representing Pine Creek, which is the Brasky Group, and they have the same exact document. Their amount is $37,000. Frank would have been here, but I got an email this afternoon that we were full and he wasn't allowed to be here. So if there's any questions, but my concern is these amendments are supposed to be recorded, and the city clerk is supposed to have a copy of them. Matter of fact, you have an ordinance that says they're required to have a copy in there. I have been there multiple times. I've FOIA'd them. They don't have any record of this transaction. That makes you wonder, are you voting for other things, and maybe the city clerk doesn't have record of that either. That's my situation that I've been dealing with. Sometimes it's tough to work in this town. You're wanting expansion. You want activity going on. And at this point in time right now, I'm the only one crazy enough to put in a new subdivision. But I've got a lot of local people working with heavy equipment and everything, And that's a heck of a lot better than them being unemployed or whatever the case might be. I'm sure it's going to be a success, but it's still up in the air. We don't, none of us know how this is all going to work out. So I'm willing to take any questions, but we've got to get this straightened out so that all developers know what's going to happen and when it's going to happen, and you're going to stick by it.
And were those the arterial roads going into the subdivision? Were those right here, Mr. Clem?
Oh, okay.
Were those the arterial roads going into the subdivision that need to be improved?
It's on Cockrell Lane and on Cokie Mill.
Okay. I know Cockrell Lane, one part of that is being received state funds, but Nate can give an update on when that would be. I think it's this fall is when that project is going to be completed.
Side, the south side of Savannah Point would be a county highway, mm-hmm. and the east side is the, I guess, city road.
Yeah, well, we appreciate, one, the development and the investment you're making. You know, you've been around, remember Piper Glen, and we appreciate all the great work you've done. And so you brought up a good point with regards to the developer's agreement, and there's some of the roads that Nate can, I'll ask him to come up to give an update, but though none of the roads had been done previous to that. So we appreciate your work on that revision of the developer's plan, as you pointed out. But Nate will come up and give a update as far as what projects that were covered under that, that will be when they would take place, or if they have.
I think what John's asking, though, is that according to the agreement, which I don't remember, it was, you know, there's a lot of water under the bridge after between that agreement and mm-hmm. and now, but I thought that, you know, number one, for us to make an agreement where it's only 1 year, to me, is kind of crazy because, right. No offense to Nate, but engineers have a tendency to stretch things out a little bit, and you can't get roads improved in a year. Not even Hilltop Road. He's not here to hear that. But so that's why I was concerned about this. Number one, I don't, you know, and. But John's got the original document, and I don't know from I haven't gone back to listen to the original meeting, you know, without the documentation in the folder, could we have amended that? Or, you know, I mean, that's the concern. So what John's saying is his year's up, so he should get his money back.
Well, and let me kind of speak to this a little bit. I didn't realize that a copy of was not in the clerk's office until actually the clerk told me about it. And so this all, just take, you know, go backwards for just a minute. This is all related, as Mr. Clem said, in relation to the developer's agreement. There were a complete rewrite, you know, of all of those issues. In Mr. Clem's case, he, under the original agreement, had a letter of credit of $176,483. That was reduced. That change the council made benefited John to the tune of $144,677.44. Now, the agreement, the revised agreement related to different road work. Instead of a three-lane, it reduced it to a 20
minimum standard.
To 22-foot thing. The exhibits that were prepared by Public Works provided for actually a two-year construction time. The form agreement that was prepared referred to a one-year. Well, everything is tied back to the exhibit, so there's an ambiguity. Do you understand? There's an ambiguity between the exhibit and what the form of the agreement says. And when this first came up, I think Mr. Clem and I believe... Who sent the other letter?
Boraski.
Was it Frank? Okay. Anyway, this came in like March 15th, I think.
March 19th. Right when it went past March 19th.
Okay. So right when COVID starts, and then I got an email, actually, I think, from Nate asking about it, and then I went back through the emails. Well, there's an email from John acknowledging the February 2021 construction date. And so my view of the situation is that if there's an ambiguity there, that as long as the city performs the work, and Nate indicated that they're going to perform the work, then there's no harm to John that would justify any sort of a refund. Now, this is just like any other legal claim where there's an ambiguity. And we deal with this, you know, these kind of issues all the time. And the circumstance is if John wants to have the money back, then he could be getting unjust enrichment if the city proceeds with the road, because then he's getting the road and doing nothing. So having the circumstance where the developer's agreement was rewritten pretty substantially, if you recall, and again, this happened back in, I think, March, April, and then today or the last couple of days is when this all kind of came up again. So from my perspective, there's now an ambiguity there between what the work that was proposed by Public Works, the schedule that's attached to that agreement, and then the form agreement that was prepared in the beginning that refers to a 1 year. And so my view is that if there's a court proceeding, the city is going to prevail on that, provided that the work is done. And so if Mr. Clem says he doesn't want the work done, then it's going to be a policy issue of do give the money back, but then there's no road.
But yeah, Alderman Hannah.
Excuse me just a second. I think I need to respond to this. With all due respect, Jim, you know that an amendment, when it's called an amendment and you created this document, it far outweighs any exhibit that would be in any other thing. And you can tell, I'm not an attorney, but luckily I have one that you've dealt with before and we prevailed. And he said, this is a slam dunk. We did exactly what this amendment said to do, and so did Boraski.
Well, but the question is, do you want the road or not?
Yeah, that's what it comes down to.
That doesn't make the question. You set out the conditions.
No.
We didn't.
Alderman Hanauer.
Look, this is my take, all right? And you guys are going to have to figure this out because it's not on us.
Correct.
But my thing is the road needs work. We had the money. And we can't have this. When we get the money, and I know we got the new agreement and everything, we've got to get on things and make sure that we don't run out. I will say, John, I thought the city gave you got a pretty good deal for going from what 170, mm-hmm. 170,000 down to 30, and now you know so. But you guys need to get together, and you guys need to figure this out. And if we have, we need to get the work done.
No doubt.
No ifs, ands, or buts.
Nate, when the work is going to be done.
Yeah, Nate's going to be coming up. But let's go back to the amendment. I mean, the whole purpose of the amendment, let's be frank, is how long was that letter of credit with the city of Springfield, the
$170,000? I paid like $18,000 letter of credit fees because nothing ever happened.
Yeah, how long has it been with the city?
I think you pointed out it was like 15 years or more.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's the reason for the amendment.
Keep in mind now, the way you're approaching this, you're giving the impression that this was the city's idea to do this. Mm-hmm. This was in conjunction. This would have never, ever happened had the Illinois Realtors not stepped in.
Actually, the Chamber of Commerce.
Chamber of Commerce to an extent, but they weren't in the conference room, in your conference room, when I was in there with the attorney and the other, our GAD, and that's where all that got worked out.
It's everybody working together, right?
But my point is here, why would you create something, and my understanding through that attorney says an amendment precludes everything that is, if it's in conflict with anything. And there again, if we had written this, I could understand. But we didn't. Mm-hmm. We looked at it, and it says 1 year. Frank and I talked about it. We said, well, these are small projects. They probably figure they can get it done in 1 year. So we never thought anything about it. We never thought even about what was going to happen until it got into like November, and we're saying, my gosh, these guys are rolling the dice on not getting that work done because it has to be done before March 19th. And it went no activity. So if that was truly a one-year thing, or why wouldn't you come in there and do it immediately?
Well, the gentleman that can answer that's coming up. Okay. So with regards to, let's go back to the beginning. It's been 15 years. The whole purpose to put in the 1 year, the 2 year, whatever it is, was to make sure the city does the work, as you're saying. So really, the city freed up. You had a $170,000 line of credit or letter of credit. It's $30,000. And Corporation Council's right. I think, we can do the work, and it's based on the participation. Because if there, say you prevail, and I imagine if that's the case, it goes to court. And if that's the case, if you prevail, then what happens is that road goes in the prioritization project list of all the other roads in the city of Springfield. So look at Archer Elevated Road, needed to be built long ago.
25 years
and
ago.
Yep, and now finally, 20 years later, it's being built because we're able to get the funds. So it comes down to prioritization. What's right is to do the work. And that's what's going to be done in the fall. So I'll let your attorney deal with our attorney and figure it out. Otherwise, it goes, you're rolling the dice when the project gets done. So I think that's the whole point. But the point of the amendment to, with regards to letter of credit, is to make sure that the city does get the roads done. I agree with Alderman Hanauer. 1 year is not realistic. I've been with any road. I mean, it's so really, that's I agree with Corporation Council on the 2 years, but that's for you and your attorney to haggle with Corporation Council. But I'd ask Nate to come up and give an update on what roads have been done and what the schedule is, especially the ones that we have letters of credit on, because I think that's the important piece of it.
Well,
Lynn Hart and Bunker. Yeah. Bunker.
The other thing I would like to bring up then, if that was the issue, why did it not get handled until 2 hours before this meeting? I get two emails from Illinois Realtors people and saying, this is what is going on right now. That supposedly I had asked for something. I haven't talked to anybody at the city in regards to what's going to happen. But the reference that they sent to the other folks said I had inquired about the road work. No, I haven't at all. I had planned to be here. Frank Paraski had planned to be here.
I think that's what precipitated it. It sounds like if you got the email today, that's probably what precipitated it.
Precipitated
the action that you received today as far as the email goes.
I was set up to be here all along.
Is he referring to just the update that,
I don't know,
that Nate prepared for you? Okay.
But Nate, if you'd come forward and give an update, we'd appreciate it. I'll let you decide if you want to wipe off the podium or not, since you're the next speaker.
I'll multitask.
That's good. We appreciate it.
No. So the work is in regards to Cokie Mill Road as well as Cocker Lane is planned to be completed by late September. Hopefully we can get it done a little earlier, but that's weather dependent. And then you just improved the Bunker Hill, Isles, and Lenhart improvements tonight. So we'll get that project scheduled. We'll have the pre-construction meeting and also plan on beginning that project in September and having that wrapped up by November.
So it'll be done
and then in
year.
Regards to the exhibit I created a year ago, it did have a February of 2021 completion date that we've been functioning under, as well as I have an email from John in regards to confirming that date.
Yep, if you want to come up, John. Sure. Come on up. In other road projects, did you cover that as far as happening, or will they be done next year? Any other roads with regards to developers? Or if you can get that report, that'd probably be good.
Well,
as far as the schedule goes.
I guess my question is, Nate, didn't we do some engineering work on Cockrell Lane does that count towards it or whatever? I mean,
I don't know.
What counts?
Well, I think let the attorneys determine.
Yeah, I know. That's
that.
Why I say it doesn't. It's going to have to get two attorneys sitting down and figuring this out because.
Right.
The other reason why I'm not buying into this is, and I didn't even think of looking at this, I give my wife credit. There is nothing planned in the any this year or next year on Cokie Mill Road or Cockrell Lane. It's not even on their chart for the this current year that's closing, and next year that is a year ahead of time is not even on their list of anything to be done. So it can't be a real critical situation.
No, it's the same thing.
Well, that goes back to my point with regards to, Nate can speak to it, but with the project itself, it all comes down to funding. And so that's where the letter of credit comes in. And so the one you have, the $30,000.
I don't have a letter of credit.
With the city?
I gave you cash and a check for that.
Okay. Well, that's better than that. Thank you very much. But what it comes down to is the project funding. So if the attorneys are going to work it out, they'll be able to work it out. If not, then the city's going to prioritize that project. Right now it's set to go, as Nate Bottom had said, in September. So if if it's decided that's not the intent, and it just depends if we take it to court or whatever the case may be. I don't know what the resolution is, but that's something, Mr. Clam, if your attorney would give ours a call, give Mr. Circle a call and figure it out, we'd appreciate it. Anybody else wish to, or I do have one more person, Garrett Moffitt. I should recognize Clyde Bunch. He's a senior member of the county board here with us. We appreciate that.
I've been a long time waiting to talk.
Oh, come on up.
Well, go ahead. You go ahead.
Oh, no, he'll wipe it off for you.
It's untouched again.
Hey, I don't need that. I'm an old man. I stand back.
No, you barely need it.
No, what I came up here for, I've already found out what it's all about. If you guys would have let me spoke a long time ago, because I do not want to speak now. I found out what the situation was and I got here. So I want to thank you for letting me come up and speak. And so all I can say is be safe out there and God bless you. I'm done. I'm out of here. Thanks.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
I was here for a reason. I was sent by the county board, but apparently nothing like that happened. So I'm happy.
Well, thanks for being here. And you even missed the Cub Cardinal game.
Huh?
You even missed the Cub Cardinal game.
I'm going to watch Cubs for a year.
Motion to adjourn.
Yep. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, say nay. We're adjourned. Thank you.
I guess Moffitt wasn't here.
No.